Okay. Yes, welcome to the podcast. This is a podcast about Dota 2, and like we're basically just going to talk about Dota and see some other people that are not well known and whatever, like some interesting people talk about Dota and stuff like that. So basically what we're going to talk about today is like the latest patch, Dota as an esport, everyone's origin in Dota and stuff like that. And today we have Hazeling, Wired Guitar and Mavav with us. If everyone wants to like say some few words about themselves or something like that, it would be great.
Yeah, I'll start off then. Mavav is my nickname, Jonas Erber from Sweden. Currently the manager for the Dota team COOKISS, which has been doing a lot of different stuff in the Dota scene. Also used to play a lot of Counter-Strike back in the days, like 10 years ago. And worked a lot of events and stuff like that, so got a broad reference points to things.
Yeah, we can go with Wired Guitar now then.
Absolutely. Hey guys, I'm Wired. I made a really controversial video that got blown up on Reddit, and that's probably how anybody would know me if they did know me. Otherwise, I'm just a 5k pleb player who spams a lot of Ur Spirit and Oracle and sometimes Terror Blade. Mostly just Ur Spirit and Oracle though. Yeah, that's pretty much it.
That leaves Asker then.
Alright, hey guys, it's me, Asker. I don't know, no one would know me because I'm not really anyone. I just played in a team with Dansk a month ago, and that's why I'm here, I guess. Yeah. Nothing to, yeah, I guess we'll go. There's a point later about our previous, like our experience with Dota as well later, so.
Yeah.
I guess there'll be more depth to that point in my character later, but yeah, not too much to say.
Yeah, and myself then, I'm Dansk basically. I play a lot of fucking Dota, pubs, whatever. I've been in the small Swedish scene in fucking forever, and I'm gonna have this podcast as many times as possible because I wanna keep doing YouTube videos again and whatever. But yeah, let's get started. So, Dota 6.86, this patch. What do you guys think about it? And what's like the favorite change in the patch and whatever? Like, it's been a while and we've been playing it a lot, but what's your favorite thing about the patch and whatever?
No, you start.
I'll start off by saying that my favorite hero in the game got released to Captain's Mode, which is really bittersweet. Obviously, it's nice to see him picked up and played in competitive games, and more importantly, you know, like wreck and face and shit. But unfortunately, to get him into Captain's Mode, they had to make a huge nerf. Obviously, I'm referring to Urspirit, by the way, if that wasn't obvious.
Yeah,
the Boulder Smash nerf. We were going to talk about this anyway, so we'll kind of jump a little bit to it now, if that's okay.
Yeah.
They nerfed his intelligence growth by a little bit, not a big deal. Boulder Smash stun AoE, kind of noticeable, but the big nerf was the pull to allies now requiring an Aghanim Scepter. That was really unfortunate. So if we want to talk about the best change, it's also coming at the price of the worst change for me, and kind of made me cry a little bit. I mean, he's still really fun to play, and I still have a 60% win rate with him over 660 games, which is actually like a really close to the devil's number there, sorry. But... yeah, but yeah, that's just like on record right now. I think I have that many games with him, and I've just got done with a 12-hour stream of mostly just playing him anyways. So, you know, I play a lot of that hero, but yeah, I'd say that was like my favorite, but then also the least favorite change, if that makes sense, from the patch. I'm enjoying it otherwise, though. There's some pretty, you know, Invoker shit. I feel like I'm talking too much, but...
No, it's fine. Like, this is what we're supposed to do, so just keep on going. This is interesting.
There's like the meta heroes right now of like Invoker, OD, and then Omni made his way into there just because of like his synergy with OD. And then like obviously you have the pro meta that favors like Sven and maybe kind of shies away from OD. But then you have the pub meta which shies away from Sven and favors OD, which is kind of a weird little back and forth there. There's also a lot of other heroes that get picked up, like Nyx and Pugna made it into the scene in the pub meta just because OD is a kind of a cancer hero. I see a fair bit of Slark and Spectre, of course. All that stuff showing up in the pub meta, and that's always, I mean, I don't know, this feels very diverse, I'll say. It doesn't feel like there's too many heroes that I just completely write off as terrible, but at the same time, there is a rigid and defined picking stage in pubs that I've never actually seen before. Like, I could be completely wrong about this, but never have I felt more cautious, even in all pick ranked, to pick my hero and be cautious about it, just because, like, I do it. Unless I'm picking Earth Spirit, then I just first pick, I don't care. But if I'm trying to pick another hero, which isn't too often, but when I do, I have to be very cautious, because, like, oh man, if there's a Spectre in this game, I'm gonna get cucked, because he's gonna build a defusal and counter me if I'm playing Omni, you know, or similar.
Would you say that, like, that's one of your favorite changes, that all pick basically got such a depth to it, basically, like, it got super hard to play all pick and whatever, like, it's more like strategic now? Or would you say, like, that's one of your favorite changes, that it's more, you need to be better?
I'd be hesitant to call it a change, just because there wasn't one specific change that says in the patch notes all pick became better. You know, there's not one change to point to, but I agree, like, overall, with all the reworks that happened, especially, like, OD got a huge rework that made the hero, like, kind of bad, and then they patched him up over two hotfixes. Remember, I think it was 6.8c at 6.86c and then 6.86d, where they buffed him twice to his Q to make it a good ability early, and, like, now it steals, like, 5 intelligence and max rank or some crazy shit like that. Like that really helped the hero become, like, a rigid carry all throughout the stages of the game and not have to worry about using his W. I think Invoker, I'm, like, gonna go completely against the grain of what, like, 90% of people say on Reddit, but, like, I actually really like Invoker, even if he's overpowered. Like, I don't even play him that much anymore, just because he's a meta hero and I don't play meta heroes that much. Well, I play Earth Spirit, but he's not a meta hero for pubs, and I'm talking about the pub scene for a second.
Yeah.
Like, I like to spam non-meta heroes in Invoker's meta right now, so I don't spam him. But I feel a lot better losing to Invoker this patch than I did to Bloodseeker in 6.84 or to Lashrak in 6.84. Those heroes, when I got killed by them, I didn't feel like I was getting killed fairly. You know, like, Bloodseeker ruptures you, and then one person on the other side of the map is 50% HP, right? Just one person. Your entire, you and everybody else on your team is full health. One person's 50% HP, Bloodseeker is now hitting for divine rapier damage, and he runs in and kills you. And that just never felt fun.
Okay.
Yeah.
But let's hear about what Mavo had to say. What's your favorite part about 6.86? What do you feel about
I just love when they, you know, rattle around in the cage a bit and just change stuff up, because it's one of the best things about Dota, that if you're gone for a couple of months, then it's such a different game. It's kind of fun when you have friends that doesn't play that much, and you get to play with them once in a couple of months, and they come, and it's you kind of have to bring them up to speed, and
yeah, they
everything
keep
that's
trying picking techies and whatever, or
yeah, and the new items as well is something that's really, I think it brings a new. At least the items we've seen now, it really brings a new depth to a lot of heroes, and it's interesting that you can, the way it's being used, and you see how Iron Talon changed the whole meta, with so many heroes can go to the jungle now, and Dragonlance and Netherlands, it's just, you have to get them, a couple of heroes, and Fairy Fire, that item can just change the whole early game in a fight, in a match. So it's I just like that they're, you know, shaking around, and I hope they will continue to do that, because it feels like it's one of the stronger points about Dota if you compare it to other esports games.
Yeah, I definitely agree. It's really fun that, like, the thing you said, like, that they just stir up, like, even if the game is balanced, they will sometimes just do something to change,
yeah,
like, so people will keep enjoying it, so it's not the same thing over and over again. That's a really good point. Like, I really like that change also, that they do that very often.
Yeah, and it makes it so much interesting if you look at the competitive scene as well, because, you know, the pro gamers, many of them see the game in a whole other perspective than we regular humans does.
Yeah.
And when Valve is just shaking up the meta and the heroes and items and everything, it's so interesting to see how things develop, which things get caught really fast to be the good stuff, and then it might fall off later when they discover that, oh, this small change that was made that nobody cared about in the beginning turns out to be this really big thing. and you see the way the meta develops over it's very interesting. It's and just imagine if they would do the same thing in like Counter-Strike, like every, you know, 4, 5, 6 months they'd just, you know, remove weapons, add new weapons, rebalance everything.
Yeah, they just added a gun in that game, right? And it became like the big fucking fire. Like, this is broken. What the fuck is this gun doing?
Yeah, yeah. People are gonna leave that game. People are really mad. It's like, yeah, but that's just our normal.
Yeah.
it's just the way it is. So and you talk about Earth Spirit. It's a nice hero. It's different. It changes it changes the way things are being done when it's picked. But it's people were much more afraid of it before it got in, and then everybody. If you look at the meta and how much it got picked in the beginning, nobody picked it because it got nerfed too much. Now it's always, you know, I think it was the most banned hero in the during the majors. So it's it's interesting to see just how the wheels are turning and everybody is figuring things out.
Yeah. I mean, we have to remember that... Sorry.
Yeah, no, it's fine. You can go on.
We always have to remember that, like, pros are humans, too. Like, even though they're, like, crazy good at the game, you know, like you said, for the first few... it was like at least a tournament. I remember Spirit really wasn't getting picked up too much, and I think he showed up a few games, and then like people were laughing and they were saying, so technically speaking, because he won the games that he was showing up in, like it was just a few, but he won all the ones that he was showing up in, and so people were like, yeah, technically speaking, Air Spirit has 100% win rate, but they were just joking about it. And then like I don't know if it was Weeha or it was somebody similar, but like somebody started like really exploiting the hero, and then they started banning it against him, and he just became a first stage ban, just like Invoker and all the other heroes of this patch, you know, like Spectre and whatnot. So yeah, no, you're completely right. I like that idea or that aspect of Dota, that they shake things up. Some, I mean, I always compare it to like a snow globe, you know, like Dota's like the snow globe of MOBAs. Like every 6 or 7 months, like you forgot about that snow globe, or I guess Ice Frog forgot about that snow globe, and he wants to go play with it again, so he just takes it and just shakes that shit up so much, and just all the little glitter falls into place over time as people figure out what to do, and then the glitter falls and it's sedated, and then Ice Frog, you know, every 6 months he's just like, I want to go back and shake up the snow globe again. And he just, like you said, 6.81, didn't the pros when that, I think they changed it sometime 2 years ago, but I remember pros saying in a Dota 2, I check Dota 2 buff every once in a while as like a news source, and they were saying something like they could actually play 6.81 for a solid another year if Ice Frog really wanted to, and they wouldn't get bored, and they thought it was a pretty balanced meta, even though like Tinker and Troll and the Sniper were all pretty stupid in that patch. But Ice Frog was like, no, I'm changing it. Like, hey, I just want to change. I don't care if it's balanced, man. I'm changing this shit, dude. People are getting bored, man. I got to change this game, dude.
Yeah, so, the great, like, that's why I think Dota has also been, like, active for so long, for so many years. Hell, isn't it up to 10 years now or something? I think Dota has been active for, like, 10 years or whatever. But that's one thing that kept it alive, that he changed so often and whatever. But, Asker, you're a bit quiet. Let's hear what you have to say. What's your opinion?
Yeah, I'm just letting you guys speak out.
Yeah,
I guess it's going to be somewhat of a response to what both of you said, and then... my personal individual point. So first off, there was the point about Invoker and Lucent to that and Pops and how it felt better than a Bloodseeker back in his prime, and that's just a testament to like the intricate balance of the game, I feel, and how it's so much more balanced in this patch, and why I like this patch and the direction Dota's taking in general a lot more. It seems like they are they're always going to be more frequent picked heroes, and that's sort of the definition of a meta, but they're not picked because they're like as OP as the Troll Sniper was, or because they're as good as the Leshrac Lina was during TI. It's just more diverse, like you can get away with picking much more variety and catering to your own mechanical skills in relation to specific heroes. So that's great. The ability, it sort of makes me reminisce about of StarCraft 1 in particular, that hasn't received that didn't receive a patch in like forever. I think the latest patch in that game was like maybe 2003-04. I'm not sure, you can correct me on that. But that game was played competitively up until like 2010. That's like several years without a single patch, because that game was just arguably balanced to perfection. And I think that's what we want to strive to have done to Dota 2 as well. And I think these recent patches have been a step towards the right direction, because we don't have the Lina Lesh in their prime, the Bloodseeker, Ferrari, or we have the Doom that was added a couple of patches ago. So favorite change, just that people can strive to play diverse and that it pays off. Like we saw OG in the, I think OG at Shanghai Major was, Frankfurt Major was like the first testament to how versatility pays off, because they had just had such a wide hero pool, and they would switch up Miracle and No-Tail on safe lane or mid constantly and just play weird shit, and it would pay off. So that was probably my favorite thing. There are like smaller things as well. I think that it seems like Valve, the balance management seem to provide more power to supports as well, with like the bounty room was introduced a long time ago, but like that was like seemed like to be the first step. Then there was I'm not sure what patch it was, it may have been 85, where they changed a lot about how gold distribution was added during assists and kills to provide more gold for supports in a maybe bigger vicinity or something like that. So I like that as well, more like striving to have a smaller diversity and a net worth change between five heroes, rather than having those two heroes at the top and then again two supports at bottom, like those really hard position 5/6s. And another another way they sort of changed that was the creep resistance, magic resistance in some of the neutral camps, sort of denying the ability to flash farm on heroes like Shadow Fiend or Lina. Just have a support stack a jungle and don't get anything the first 3 minutes, but it will pay off because you get a super fat core through it. So that I'm not sure if that's the one specific thing I like about this patch, but just the way the direction Dota's heading in general, I really like.
I like those points a lot, actually. Especially the idea behind I wasn't trying to cut off anybody, by the way. I apologize. I'm not trying to step on anybody's toes here. So if you guys have anything to say, because I feel like I'm talking already too much.
No, this
please.
Is perfect. Like, just go.
Go ahead,
just
buddy.
Have to think about the time. Like, they spend a lot of time. But yeah, go on.
No, I definitely like what he said, because as somebody, I play usually position 4 in pubs. Like, that's the way I run Ur Spirit, is I just roam support all the time. And so, I mean, I'm not usually the one that's, like, the bitch support, like, buying all the wards or anything like that, unless, like, we get a jungle Legion commander. And you saw my post about that. Like, then bite the bullet and play total bitch support. But even still, like, even if it isn't pubs and it's not competitive, so, like, obviously I'm not going to be stacking that much because it's not a coordinated game, so I'm not going to be, you know, picking Alchemist or something like that, or my core is not going to be picking Alchemist. Like, I've noticed that there's a lot less of a reliance on stacking to begin with. Not because it's, like, any weaker, but just because it is a little bit, I guess it is a little bit weaker, but mostly because there's a lot more reliance, like you said, on, like, getting these early game kills. Like, they changed, it was a few patches back, not even a few, I think it might have just been last patch, where they changed creep gold worth by about, I think it was 7%, so it was like 3 or 4 gold per creep was, like, taken off of your last hits, but kills were worth 10% more. And then, like we were also saying with the assist gold, like, just getting the kill nowadays is more worth it than just, like, trying to feed the kill to your core. So just in general, at least for the pub meta, from what I've seen, like, picking really, really good roam supports and just making the game, like, action-packed straight from minute 2 or 3 has been, like, the thing to do. And I've had a lot of success doing that as well. And there's a lot of mids, even though Quap's kind of getting phased out a little bit, and like even though Shadow Fiend's also kind of getting phased out, like two heroes that are vastly different when they're in the mid. Like Shadow Fiend, very, very vulnerable, doesn't have any escape. Quap, not vulnerable at all unless you have like a silence or a long stun, you know, because she has her blink. Like, even though both those heroes are, I don't see as much, I definitely see a lot less Shadow Fiend than I do Quap, but even Quap kind of see a lot less of her, mostly just Invoker, OD, you know, whatever else somehow manages to make it past that. Like, I still see that there's a lot of aggression being applied mid, and like it's a support's job to have a fun game of moving around the map, helping all the lanes out, and not playing like a farming simulator for your carries, or I guess like a farming assist simulator where you're just stacking camps and making sure the runes are okay and stuff, you know, because that's not, I don't like that. I mean, it has its fun elements, because like you said, Asker, like, you have the element of knowing that you get a big payoff with your core getting fat, but I'd much rather like go get a kill in a lane than, you know, stack the jungle camps for 5 minutes and then watch the money pile up. So
yeah, okay. Well, I can just be short on what I think about this patch. I think the patch is the same as the Leshrac Lina patch, basically, but with two other heroes. But and my favorite change is just that Ricky is a fucking so good right now. But I'm not gonna go in more depth because I don't want to waste more time on it. But let's talk about four items. What?
Can I just ask you quickly, which two heroes do you think compare to Lina Lesh?
I think that OD and Evoker are like, they are not the same heroes. They don't have the same abilities in any concept, but I think they are built like the Lina Lesh is like the Evoker OD is the new Lina Lesh, basically. They both were insta picked in pub or whatever. They're both really good in competitive. We just changed the abilities basically on our mids. I think the game is still kind of the same in the mid lane, but the off lane got changed and whatever. But I don't really like how they did it. But yeah, I'm trying to be quick here. So let's talk about the items. Ether Lance, Iron Talon, Dragon Lance, and Fairy Fire got added to the game in this patch 6.86. My favorite out of those items is obviously Iron Talon. I think that gave the game a whole new perspective, and that was actually one of the parts where I found Wired Guitars videos, because I was like, this item is interesting. I wonder what people have, what people do with it. So I started Google and I found this guy, and he did like these super strange videos about Terrorblade and whatever, and it was super interesting because it gives a whole new perspective on the game. Like, before we didn't, we had like Enigma, Shen, Enchantress, and Lycan that could jungle or whatever, but now everyone can jungle. Like, RTK's style on the offlane right now is picking Tidehunter and first item Iron Talon and go jungle. Like, how is that not fucking amazing? It's such a good item. But you guys can share a bit what you think about the new items and what's your favorite item, what's whatever.
Yeah, I already said some things about it. Iron Talon, it's an interesting item. It's something that I think had biggest change of all these items when it comes to the game. I don't know if it's that good, though, that you can go jungle with pretty much any hero. Neither in competitive or in pubs. In pubs, it's, I guess it doesn't really matter that much because, you know, it's pretty much anything can work. But I don't know. I haven't really decided yet what I think about that item. I think almost like the Fair Fire item is, I see so many situations that now is where, you know, where you can heroes getting ganked early in the game and you get to turn the fight around because it's a Fairy Fire item that people doesn't really expect yet that you have, and you get the healing from it. So it's that's a fun item to abuse, at least at my level of play, even though I don't get to play that much Dota. Yeah, but I think I always. What do you other think about Iron Talon and its role?
I feel like I have to at least say something, just because especially that's how you found me. So when it comes to Iron Talon, and I've mentioned this in like other videos too that I've made since then, but like none of them get popular at all because I'm a no name. But I you know, originally in the video I was talking about how, and actually I shouldn't even speak from the perspective of the video because I can't assume anybody's seen it, but basically. Like you guys are saying, you know, most heroes can make it at least somewhat, I'll say maybe 200 GPM in the jungle, like on a fucking, I don't know, Shadow Shaman or something like that. Like, it's not good, right? 200 GPM isn't even like a denied offlaner, because usually they can somehow find farm either through the jungle, the hard camp next to them, or through the little few creeps that sip through. So it's not good GPM or whatever. And like, I remember trying it on Invoker. As the patch started, when Alacrity gave +20 damage at the start of at the level one or whatever. So you hit level 2, you get Alacrity, you kite the camp with Alacrity and Iron Talon, and you know, you got like 250 GPM, and I was just like, dude, like, how is this in the game? Like, this is so stupid. And then Invoker got nerfed, so it turned out that maybe Invoker was the OP one. But then I started to think more about the item, and I was like, you know, even if this wasn't nerfed, even if Invoker wasn't nerfed, this still probably wouldn't be that good. Because to look at an item like Iron Talon and to look at the jungle as a whole as something that could flourish in Dota, you have to look at it from the perspective of outside of the jungle. So don't focus on how much GPM, how much EXP you're getting in the jungle. Look at what's happening all throughout the game, and top, mid, bot, or safe lane, hard lane, and mid. Like, look at the perspective of those lanes and how they're suffering because you pick jungle, and then you can see why it's not actually overpowered. There are some exceptions, obviously, right? Like, I don't know if you guys have tried this, but like, I actually tried getting an Iron Talon on Enigma, even though it kind of seems redundant because you can already transmute a creep, but it's actually like really good. Like, you can only it's so, like, it's really quick. Like, you can convert the small one and then damage the big one. Like, it's really quick. Lycan, obviously, even though he lost his crit at early ranks, you know, and he only has it on his ulti now, for his wolves, obviously, like, he's sped his jungle up even still. Junglers that were known became faster, and then junglers that just needed a little bit of a boost to become like semi-decent junglers in terms of GPM and EXP can now technically jungle. But you always have to think of it from the perspective of, okay, how is this going to affect the game? Well, I'm going to be AFK in the jungle for the first 8 or 9 minutes, so that means my safe lane is going to get shat on because they're missing a support. I can't TP for mid. Enchantress or Chen or Enigma or anything like that, right? If you're picking like Legion Commander or Lifestealer, you know, we've got to assume that those are the heroes you're picking, because that's like, when we're talking about any hero can jungle, we're not talking about the heroes that could jungle and just not got better. We're talking about the heroes that could not jungle, and then Iron Talon gets introduced and now they can jungle. When you're talking about it from that perspective, it becomes, well, what is happening in the game that I'm jungling? Am I just farming up a Midas so that I can be a douchebag to my team and just spit on them for the first 20 minutes of the game until we just barely drone on and hold high ground for just long enough for it to become impactful that they have a fourth core and that we get to win the late game, and just pray that my team doesn't lose a 4v5 for the first 20 minutes? Or is it like, maybe I should pick somebody who's maybe a little bit weird, you know, maybe like Lifestealer, you know, I flame on him a lot, but like the way that some people make him work is like they'll jungle for a little bit and then they'll surprise them with level 6 getting a centaur and running out with tranquil boots, because the creep gets the movement speed from tranquil boots but doesn't get the break, and it's kind of weird, but like, you'll fool a lot of people. Like, not a whole lot of people are gonna like look at a centaur running out stunning them and be like, what the fuck, you know? They're not gonna look at it and dodge it until it's like right up in their face and it stuns you. So it's a pretty easy gank. I used to love doing that kind of stuff. And like Legion Commander, like farming nothing but just a blink dagger and then just blinking on somebody with nothing, but they're at like 200 HP. So your lane opponents, all they needed you to do was hold them down. And that's what you can do because you farmed a blink dagger and you got it up in 9 minutes. And even though you don't have treads and you have like zero right click, like, you're holding them there for 4 seconds so your team can just come up and wail on them with right clicks. You know, it's those kinds of things that I think would allow junglers to be a little bit more accepted. But what I hate the most, I hate this so much, is when I see a jungle Lifestealer farm a Vlads and then go Radiance, or I see a jungle Legion Commander farm a Midas or treads into Wand or some stupid crap like that. Like, I see that all the time for some reason in 5K, and it's just like, I just don't understand how they can't understand how that kills the team. That just breaks apart.
It's really interesting how you see the item, because I see it in a whole other way. Like, Iron Talon makes it, like, if we see it from, they don't pick it that much more on another hero than on the offlane and non-competitive. But basically, let's say you're in the last stage of, like, drafting and whatever, and you see that the enemy team goes with an Enigma. They have a greedy position 4. You don't have that. You cannot fight the greed. You have to be putting pressure, but your picks don't allow you to do that. What can you do? You can pick your Iron Talon jungler, like Legion Commander or whatever. Like, it gives you more variety in like the competitive scene, and it gives also you a second chance in pubs. Let's say you're going against an Enchantress with nothing that can stop her. What are you gonna do? You just go into the jungle because you're gonna get more farm there. Like, that's how I see the item. And yeah, people gonna do retarded shit everywhere. Like the Vlad's Radiant shit, I tried it and it's redundant. Like, it's based on, it's like you're rolling dice. Like, if your team won 4 versus 5, they have already won the game for you and you will win with them, but you're gonna lose the game for your team playing. They're gonna play 4 versus 5. Yeah.
It's going to generate another kind of playstyle though for the offlaners. As you said yourself earlier, RATK going with Tidehunter, going to the jungle straight away. It's a different kind of offlaner, and it's, isn't it? It does it become a bit easier that if you fail your offlane, you can just go into the jungle with pretty much any hero at all.
Yeah,
it's. I know you used to play a lot of offlane Dansk, if I don't remember wrong.
Yes.
And it's. This game shouldn't be easy. It's not what we like about this game, right?
No, it makes it harder though for the supports. Offlaners always had a hard time, like, because it's the hard lane and whatever, but it put pressure on the enemy supports, but because if the enemy offlaner is missing, he's probably at the secret camp or in the enemy jungle. Like, you can put a smoke or whatever and kill him or push the tier 1 tower. I don't think it makes the game easier, it just makes it harder for some other players. But this leaves like Senta Warrunner or Tidehunter or whatever, they cannot go against a tri lane. It's impossible. Yeah. Like, they will die. But if you want the heroes to be picked, they have to have something so they can survive the early game. And that's what I think they did with Iron Talon.
Yeah, I think you're completely right. So the way that I see it done, I've seen this. I think we were watching the same game. Maybe. What happened was that guy ROTK or whatever. He went to the off lane, but he wasn't like staying there. Like, he went to the off lane with the intention of making sure that they don't push his tier one tower. And once he confirmed that they weren't pushing, then he goes and farms the secret camp. And then when he realized that they were freezing the lane, then he walks down to his jungle and farms it. And then he always has a TP on himself, so that way, whenever they push the tier one tower, he can just TP up there, leech the EXP, and pull the creep wave past. So the idea is that you're still technically guarding the off lane. You're kind of like you're kind of like a guard that just goes on patrol. Like, you're going to be in the off lane if it ever gets pushed, but as long as they're freezing the lane, you will never ever go up there, and you're just going to farm the jungle. So it just gives because the off lane, like we talked about earlier, like, the off lane kind of got fucked this patch, right? Like, the addition of the new pull camp for both sides and just greater awareness of, hey, supports don't have to just pull one camp, we can just side pull. It really kind of gimped the offlane in some ways, and that's why I used to play Ur Spirit. Like, I got like a 300 games. Half of my Ur Spirit games are playing him offlane, and I just don't do it anymore in this patch, just because of how difficult it became. Because the way that he would control the offlane is he would pull a creep into the. I'm sure you've seen this before. Like, Ur Spirits will pull a creep. Maybe you've seen. I don't know. They'd always pull a creep into the trees next to their offlane to get. Like, to deny a creep so that they could get the lane equilibrium near their tower. You can't really do that well this patch, because they're just going to side pull, and then, like, you can't leech, you can't go out there, you know, against a tri lane. They're just going to kill you, like, 100% of the time. So, unless you want to go AWOL and buy, like, a pack of sentries to block two camps at the start of the game, you know, you're just gonna pick a jungler or a hero that can sustain themselves off the jungle camp. Like, Lone Druid's really good at doing it. Beastmaster's really good at doing it. Tidehunter's really good at doing it. Centaur can do it. Legion. I've seen Legion offlane. It kind of works. You know, she can get levels. Like, it's more of an offlane item, and that's what I came to accept Iron Talon as.
Yeah. Okay, Oscar, what do you think? What's your favorite item from this patch? And what do you think about Iron Talon as an item?
I think you're overestimating the power of the Iron Talon a lot. I don't think it's as significant as an item, honestly. It's pretty much like exclusively used for the offlaners, and furthermore, like melee offlaners. I don't care much for it. Like, it's fine. I don't think it ruins the game. It doesn't ruin pops. It doesn't, like, it did ruin some pops because people thought they could go woods on every hero. But I mean, I think you just have to climb a bit of MMR and get to a point where people have some better game knowledge than to fifth pick like some useless wood hero and sit there for 20 minutes.
What MMR is that, though? Because I see it all the time, and, like, I've played, I'm not trying to cut you off, I've played, like, 15 games today, and, like, over half of them had a jungle Legion commander in it.
Like, I barely see it. I'm 5.4 at the moment.
Fuck. Okay.
Yeah, maybe. So anyway, my favorite item is the Aether lens and sort of what it represents. I like the Glimmer Cape a lot as well. Like, it's cheap items with a great build up, which again empowers the the supports a lot and enables them to do much more. Like, I think the Aether lens is much more significant. That's actually like it's actually like revitalized the Lina, I think, to a high degree, and like and heroes in general, and just adds more depth than the Iron Talon does. I don't know. I just like the Aether lens a lot more. Maybe because it says, yeah, I don't know.
An item like Aether lens, don't you feel like it makes the game harder to balance? Because now he has to think about every hero getting increased cast range. Like, every hero has that option up. Like, let's say they do something with Terrorblade and they make the ulti some way that it's gonna be beneficial to get 200 cast range and stuff like that. It could happen. I just feel like Aether lens, before it got nerfed, 8% spell damage or what it was, like, it was
magic resistance.
Yeah, it was like such a weird item because it just makes the Ice Frogs work harder. Like, it has so much to think about. Like,
yeah, sure, crazy. But I mean, that's the problem with every item. That's the problem with Iron Talon as well. And some people thought that Legion Woods was like ridiculous for like a week, and then the meta settled in and everyone sort of like that was just a phase. I don't think that, like, do you look at Aether lens now and feel like any hero has abused it so ridiculously hard that it should be nerfed at a point? Like, the only reason it got nerfed was because it was just like way too good stats and for way too low of a price. For like, build up was insane. The 200 range every support hero can use, and you got spell resistance as well and whatnot. Like, do you look at any hero now and say, ah, yeah, I think this item arguably has to be removed, but because like 200 extra range on this hero, nah, that's just too strong. I don't think it does. I haven't seen it abused on everyone really.
Is one hero I looked at that way. Like, don't want to nerf Zeus because he's in a good spot in my opinion. Like, he does good damage. He has a purpose and he's a mid hero. Like, we need more mid heroes in the game. But an item like Aether lens is way too fucking good, like, on a hero like him.
Like, but why is he not picked more then?
I feel like he's picked.
He's picked more, yeah, for sure. He was like pretty much dead last patch, and like Lina, like the Aether lens revitalized him as well as Lod. But I don't think like he's good, yeah, and he fits like a lot with the Spectre, which is a pretty popular pick these days as well, but I don't think it makes him OP at all. I think,
Could it be said that maybe Zeus is strong just because of the current other heroes in the patch that are strong? So, like, it's not the same way as Omni Knight, because that hero is good with any core that's, like, really strong, but, like, so Zeus, for one of the things he does is he wins mid lane no matter what, pretty much. I can't think of any hero off the top of my head that actually beats him. You know, they just kind of, like, Quinnipain, you think?
Yeah.
I don't know. With the Q.
Which hero?
I think Quinnipain Zeus versus wins hands off. Like, if you have
against
one
Zeus, yeah, for sure. I agree.
Okay. I've never played that matchup. I don't play a whole lot of Zeus or Quap, but I don't know. I don't play a whole lot of mid. But I just mean that, like, I know that OD and Invoker both kind of struggle a little bit against him, at least in the first few levels, right? Like, especially OD, he just can't do anything to his Zeus. It's the same thing like Lina versus OD. Like, you just can't do anything against them. Your range is so short. From my experience, I mean, maybe you guys have a different story to tell. I just know that, like, so, like, that's one of the reasons why Zeus could be considered strong, is because he wins that lane, and those heroes are so strong right now. In their lens.
Sorry. I disagree a lot with that, because I don't think Zeus really wins any, that's an over-exaggeration, but any mid lineups. Like, he can't deny a single creep, and he does some decent magic damage, but as soon as you don't, like, fucking tank every arc lightning, you're gonna be fine in that lane, and you can farm on most heroes, and he's like a slow hero with no escape ability.
Yeah.
Lower HP pool, like, yeah, he's too vulnerable to be considered like a really good like tier one mid hero. I don't think
I think
Zeus is a fine, like, Zeus is a hero you pick and you know he's gonna get farmed, but you know your enemy mid is gonna get that too, so you only pick him because you're gonna be fine with that.
So I just wanted to correct real quick an inaccuracy. You said he had a low HP pool. Zeus actually has like one of the highest. He's like 19 starting strength, which is amongst the higher, and then he has a 2.3 strength gain. Like, he's actually quite tanky if you look at the stats from that perspective. And like, he likes to build like tanky items like Bloodstone or Octarine, I see, or like Ags or any of that shit, like outside of Veil and Aetherlands, which, you know, obviously don't provide any extra HP. But I just mean he'll eventually get tank ability. But I do agree that like he can't deny a creep, but I feel like the way that he denies creeps is by pushing the lane into the tower, which is something that like OD and Invoker at very early ranks kind of struggle to fight against, especially OD, where he can't spam his Q early ranks because he has to worry about mana. You know what I mean? I feel like he at least wins against OD.
Yeah, I can agree.
Do you disagree with that?
I disagree again.
OD has a low attack range, in my opinion. Like, I would never say that Zeus wins. And like, when I see winning a lane, I see them like out leveling the enemy the enemy laner or whatever. But what Zeus does is that he don't lose any matchup. Like, he can't lose a matchup because all he does is arch lightning the creep wave, and he will not die. So I don't think he wins any matchup at all. He just equalizes against every matchup, and that's pretty fucking good for a pick. Like, you can pick him first in competitive, and you know that you won't have problems with your mid. Like, he will get farm. So that's what I think. Does Zeus kind of good at least? But I don't see him winning. I definitely don't see him winning because he has no CC at all. You need rotations for that or whatever.
Yeah.
I think we should move on, by the way. One item that we have not talked about at all, that no one mentioned, is the Dragonlance. Is the item garbage, or like, it's the only item you can disassemble?
Disassemble, yeah. I don't know how to feel about that item. Like, it's fine on... Like, the only heroes I really see pick up on a regular basis is like OD and Dro, and even then it's very situational. It's a fine item. Yeah, enchanters. Yeah. But that's an item for like three heroes on a regular basis. I don't worry about that item either. I think it's fine. It's just a bit weird to add an item and then nobody uses it. So I think they're gonna be looking into changing that or nerfing it, buffing it, doing something to it.
So you think it's bad?
Just poor design, I'd say. Not bad. It's just so niche, you know. It only fits on a few heroes, like you said, and so like that's poor design for an item if only a few heroes can buy it. Doesn't mean the item's bad, it just means that it's poorly designed. The stats that it gives, I didn't think were bad initially, but then I read a little bit more into it and I was like, you know, strength is always nice, but like, what if that just gave like more flat damage or some shit like that? Like, what if it could turn somebody like Sniper into even more of a crazy glass cannon or something? I don't know, just something that would make a little bit more sense, as opposed to like not all ranged heroes want that kind of strength. And like, Drow is the kind of hero to build a Shadow Blade or a Blink Dagger anyways to get some sort of mobility. Usually if Drow gets jumped on, she's dead. And that's why she would want the extra range, but she wouldn't want the extra HP, I don't feel like. I mean, again, I guess she could break it apart. I don't know, Drow's kind of a poor hero to begin with, even if she's kind of getting buffed slowly over patches. Like, I'm sure that Dragonlance would show up a little bit more if a hero like Drow was showing up a little bit more. Kind of like the OD effect that you talked about. Like, okay. Yeah, he can get the item.
So this patch, Earth Spirit, Oracle, and Terrorblade got all added to Captain's mode. Like, what do you feel like if we talk about in a competitive perspective? What did this give? Like, of course, it's great new heroes. We're gonna see more heroes in competitive or whatever. But like, how is this gonna affect? Like, or how did this affect this patch or whatever? Like, in my personal. I love that Earth Spirit got added because I waited for that hero for so long. I really think it's weird that it needed to get nerfed because we had good heroes. Like, Earth Spirit was a really good hero before, and I feel like, why can't we just add him when he's really good? Because we had really good heroes in Captain's mode before. I think it's fun that Earth Spirit is in the competitive because we have, for example, he's a really good mid Earth Spirit, and it's good to watch and whatever. What do you guys feel about these three heroes and like their competitive value?
Well, Terrorblade is a non-factor.
Yes.
Just to start that off.
Yes.
It's I'm looking at like stats pages and so on. He's been picked some.
Yeah.
Got a negative win rate and so on, but it's. It's picked more than like anti-mage right now, it seems. But you know, it's I know there were a lot of teams that were experimenting a lot with him right after the patch was released. A lot with him and Death Prophet, and just making a lineup that just couldn't be killed. But nah, it's not that. It's just bad. It's still just bad. Earth Spirit we talked about a lot already. I
just want to go back to Terrorblade real quick. Like, what do you think is that makes him so bad? Like, what do you feel? Like, he got a change to the reflection, or whatever. Like, it's AoE now. I think that's really good. But what do you feel personally that he needs to be more like a tier one pick, for example? What do Terrorblade need to become a tier one pick? For example,
personally, on the topic of Terrorblade, I feel like it's one of those heroes that just hasn't settled in the meta at all. I feel like what happened with Terrorblade was he was a certain way at a point, then they changed him up a lot and removed him from captain's mode for a long time, and people were complaining a lot about reflection because that spell is, I think, pretty strong. And then I think people were just afraid to play him. Like, they didn't bother playing him for a long time because it seemed like Val was just going to change him at some point, because I just think the hero doesn't seem thoroughly balanced. Like, the damage on Metamorphosis is really high, and like the Sunder can just turn something really quickly. So I think no one really bothered playing him, and that's why when he got introduced, people still just don't understand how to play him and what to do with him. Like, the only people I've really seen, like, I've only seen him in the SEA scene, specifically Miracle, playing it with actually high success, I feel like. So I don't feel like the hero is shit at all. I just feel like no one's bothering with him at all because they didn't expect him to be introduced the way he was. And yeah, he's just sort of overlooked, and no one wants to bother with him. That's my opinion on him.
Yeah. He's my second most played hero, so if I can chime in real quick. Like, I played him a lot when he was really overpowered back in 6.8. It was at the start of 6.82, before they even made 6.82b, where they nerfed his conjure image shit. Like, this was back when he had, like, 300% damage incoming from illusions, and he had, like, no movement speed reduction on Metamorphosis. Like, he was a really good hero. And I'd have to agree, like, they nerfed him really, really heavily, right? Because he definitely needed it. He was getting, like, first pick, first ban back then. That was, like, 2 or 3 years ago or something like that. And then they just kind of left him alone for a very long time, so everybody kind of thought he was shit. And then the way in which they reworked him was to turn him into, like, this team fight-oriented, like, I have a big, crazy ability now. Because it was always kind of weird, like, Terrorblade's the carry with 4 active abilities. Usually carries have, like, 1 or 2 passives, you know? But, like, he had no passives to kind of complement his kit. It was just kind of like, you know, Metamorphosis, to say the very most. But he has a really shit intelligence growth. He has decently costing mana, decently costing spells on his mana pool. So he has to build, like, stat boosting items that also in some way further his mana. So he has to, like, you know, Ultimate Orb is, like, his favorite item. You know, he builds that into, like, a Scotty, builds into a Manta and stuff like that. And some people go, like, Sanjin Yasha and stuff like that, you know. It builds kind of controversial on him as well. I did see the Miracle game as well, that he played, and that was a pretty good display of what he can do. But overall, yeah, there's a lot of untapped potential there. Like, the hero does have some, I think he fits into some compositions. Like, there's a lot of unknown things about reflection too. Like, I don't think people know this, but, like, it activates on illusions too. So he used to get, like, hard countered by PL because he couldn't do any AoE damage whatsoever. But when they changed his reflection, like, now he can create his own illusion army to counter PLs. And they create their own illusions. Like, the illusions that spawn, the reflection illusions, like, they have PL's passives on him, on them. So if you get a bunch of PL illusions and you use your Q on those PL illusions, then all of those illusions that spawn will start attacking his illusions and then create their own illusions. If that's not too mindfucky, I don't know. I'm not trying to, like, blow your brains out, but yeah, it's really, yeah. So, like, I'm not saying he downright counters PL, because PL can always use his W, you know. But, like, say it's on cooldown, you know, because he has a bunch of illusions, like, already spawned or something like that. Like, it's really good. And I mean, at the start of the patch, I was 6.5 when I saw the first when I saw them first rework him. I was thinking, like, maybe Blink Dagger might be good on him right now. Like, the hero has changed a lot, and I haven't seen anybody, and I haven't heard of anybody experimenting around with it, or any teams really experimenting around with it. So I feel like it's too early to write him off completely. I do think that he could use some small tweaks to make him a little bit more consistent, because, like Asker said, like, He's got a lot of freaking damage on Metamorphosis, but he has like the third lowest strength gain in the game. And he has like crazy teamfight ability with Sunder, but like if you get silenced at the last second, or if you get bursted down too quickly because of your really low strength gain, or because it has like a 0.25 second cast time, like if you mismanage that, then you'll just die and you'll get zero value out of it. So there's a lot of like trade-offs with him. Kind of feels like a Huskar at times, where you get really low on HP and you're like always teetering on the brink of death. And if you fuck up once, you're gonna just throw the game for your team.
The way I see on Terrorblade is like of course their abilities are not the same, but I see him as a bad version of Nagasairen. Like Sunder works in the way, like if you get Sunder off, you win the team fight or whatever. If you get Sleep off in a team fight or whatever, you will get Rax or like Ratting basically. Like I don't really understand. I think the conjure image ability where he creates an illusion, I feel like that's kind of where he should have a passive or whatever. I don't really think we need more illusion heroes in the game, because Nagasairen does this pretty well. It's just my personal opinion. Like you said, it was pretty good in the SC8 scene or whatever, the Miracle guy. But from my perspective, he's just a bad Nagasairen. I cannot understand why anyone would think it's good, because people don't pick Nagasairen either right now. I just feel it's kind of weird. But
it's much less greedy than Nagasairen, but we can move on to next topic.
Yeah, okay. So yeah, we're talking a lot about patch, but let's talk about some esport right now. Shanghai Mayors, oh boy. So that was a shit Mayors in my opinion. A lot of stuff that went wrong that shouldn't have gone wrong or whatever. It's kind of the worst Valve event I have watched, at least. How do you think this will this hurt the Asian scene or whatever? Like, how will this affect Dota? Like, that failed production value or whatever. Like, what do you guys think about the event? Not the game, but the event as a whole.
It hurts all of Dota, just to be clear. I don't think it just hurts any specific scene. Like, if Dota's ever suffering anywhere, then all of Dota's suffering, if that makes sense, you know? Like, that's my two cents on that. I can't see how this would only hurt one particular area of the scene.
Like,
no, I think they're gonna have a major regardless in China because of how big of scene is, and how big part of the competitive scene is filled out by like Chinese players. Like, it wouldn't make sense for Valve to go out and say, oh, We had a bad event with the Perfect World in China. Now we're gonna host majors in all the other regions of the world. I don't think it's gonna change anything other than like give Dota as a whole a bad reputation, or Perfect World rather, and people are gonna be skeptical next time they buy the compendium and buy hats from something in relation to Perfect World.
Yeah.
Well, there is no such thing as bad PR, right?
I don't think
this is gonna hurt Dota in general that much. Maybe the Chinese scene a little bit. I don't know if you can hear it now. There's someone very angry outside this door of mine here. It's bedtime soon here in Sweden. No, but I don't think it's we have gotten a lot of attention. It's gotten to that point that people in other esports and so on feel a bit sorry for us, because it's really, you know, we have done so many great, and Valve done so many great events before, and it's been other great events in China. It's just, you know, everything that could go wrong went wrong. If I don't know if we should go into details, if it's the Chinese corporate standard, you know, the way my people are doing stuff in China, or if there are special people that were this. The Reddit has gone over this so many times now, so it's pretty much everything is on the table. But it's I just think the next major event that's going to be China, because it's going to be the next major event in China, that one needs to be flawless. And I think it's not a question about if it will be flawless. It's going to be, I think it's going to be an amazing event, and everybody's going to be like redeem themselves. The Chinese scene is, people are angry. I saw some picture that they have started boot camping for the next major tournament ready and stuff like that. You know, it's just, but when people get the way this event went was an insult to many Chinese players and the Chinese professional scene and so on. If you look at it, and how the way the result of the team, the result of the event, and I think you're going to see a power surge coming from that scene now. And it's also interesting because if you look at the reshuffle that is going on now, if you look at like new Vici Gaming lineup, they actually brought in some new talent. It's not the same, 20 people that we've been seeing in the top Chinese teams just switching around, which you never play before. They have actually brought in a pub star, and I think we're going to see some really cool stuff happening from that part of the Dota scene in the next coming of months. Yeah. That's my 5 cents.
Any objections? One single objection. I don't think the quality of the next event is going to be relevant at all. It should be like that, but it seems like from what I've gathered from personal experience and the opinions of other, Valve just doesn't seem to give a shit about the community, honestly. Like, I've heard this from several people. If you watch the PPD vlogs after the day of the firing of James Toogood, that was like his exact words. He said something like, he was circle jerking Valve hardcore. He was like, you guys need to realize Valve doesn't give a shit, and we need to just be grateful that they're giving us Dota and this platform. I wouldn't be here if they weren't, la la. And like, I heard the streamer Destiny say something similar, and it reflected in a lot of what they do. Like, they have like 340 people in their staff on like one of the biggest platforms in online gaming, Valve that is, and like, it's reflected in anything from their customer service to the feedback they get from the community to the competitive players' feedback and all of that. I don't think they're gonna care about the community. It seems like they're just selling out hard, and people are sucking it up, and I don't think anyone is gonna care really.
Okay, I have some valid points. So let's talk about like the actual esport about Shanghai, the teams. Like, for the next major, it's gonna be in the Philippines, in Manila, right? Or where was it? The next one?
Yes. Okay. Manila. Yes.
So
all of Asia, in Manila.
Okay. So the top three teams, potential teams for the next major. Like, we saw some really upsetting things. Like, MVP went fucking crazy this major, for example. Do you think something will like that will happen in the next one? Like, and what potential teams will do it or whatever?
I think one interesting thing that we saw was, yeah, sure, teams like Complexity and MVP did really, really well. But at the same time, there was a clear difference in level between them and, if you know, Liquid, Secret, EG. And some people have said that, not to like bring their... bring what they've done down, because they did really well, but it's still such a big difference between the top teams and those teams, that and that room between there. It used to be Chinese teams in between there. They aren't there now. But at the same time, I think it's really cool that the Korean scene is coming around. Unfortunately, Nexon has given up Dota 2 there. I don't think they even have an own server anymore. They have to play on some other server. But it's having one really good team or more good team coming from that area is something that would just be good for Dota. And the same thing with the North American scene. If Complexity can, even though I would say it's a Swedish team. It's more than an American team.
Yes,
but it's
yes, it is.
But it's a good thing that more good teams come from different places. At the same time, the season, they didn't have anything at all to say at this major, and I really haven't seen that much people question what's happening there either.
Fnatic, like Mush and those.
Fnatic.
Not the CEA, the CIS, you know, the Russians.
Oh, the Russian. Oh, yeah, Virtus Pro, yeah.
CIS.
Yeah. Okay, sorry.
Yeah. Yeah, Virtus Pro, Riga, Team Spirit, they were there. Didn't go that well for any of them. That's a very important part of the Dota community, because
it's the core of the community, I would say. But do you feel like the patch was not fitting Virtus Pro and Team Spirit, or that they just worse than the others?
Nah, I don't think it's that. When you get to that level, you know, the versatility in the teams needs to be as big that you can handle the changes in the patches. Otherwise, you don't deserve to be there. I just think it's been so much weird stuff happening in that scene for the last couple of months. And we look at a team like Empire, they have been struggling really hard. Navi has been struggling really hard. And this is a team that's been like the major powerhouses in that area. And now, I want to see a real big team from that area again. But it's... I don't think we're going to see that big a change to the top teams to the next major.
So you think it will be like Secret, Liquid, and like EG, or what do you think?
Yeah, I think OG also underperformed. Depending of if patches and rebalances, it's some teams that can, you know, as you said, they can come do better or do worse, but it's. I'm just really interested in to see what's going to happen in the Chinese scene now, and see if they have started to get that new blood is good. You need to get some new vibes, some fresh blood.
Yeah.
And I hope we're going to see that scene bloom up again.
Yeah, same here. So let's take it over to Oscar. Like the three potential teams for next mayor, man. What's your thoughts about that?
I'm just going to keep it a short point first. I think overall predictions on teams in major events is so volatile, because it's so common that we have these upsets. We had it at TI5 as well. Like Complexity as well made it really far, and like a wildcard team made it all the way to the finals and took second, a team no one barely knew and that hadn't performed previously. And at the same time, teams consistently performing pretty well, like really well, like eHome, for example, I had as my prediction win on the compendium, because they just won MPL in really convincing fashion, got knocked out in the bottom spot. So top three, regardless, I think EG is consistently top three and has been for such a long time, especially like even through minor roster changes. Secret has its up and downs, but they seem to be back on track. They'll probably fall off before next major, though, and then they'll come back up again. Liquid, I do not personally believe in. I'm not sure how they made it that far. I mean, their games speak for themselves, but I'm still not convinced on their ability. I just think sort of weird to say, but I think they need like individual skill more on the team. I don't like Fada as a player currently. Let's see. EG, OG could flourish again and come back, and it's hard to say with the Chinese shuffles. I think it was LGD looked really fucking strong with maybe, and then they had aggressive over like maybe an aggressive on one team. I'm already sold, so they can probably come back. I think EG is the only one I feel pretty confident on when it comes to top three.
Yeah, they're pretty consistent and has been for a long while. So, over to you, Wired.
So I'll tell you a little quick story, and then we'll talk about the predictions real quick, if that's okay, right? I promise it ties to the predictions.
Yeah,
okay?
That's good.
So there's a very small time in my life where I gave a lot of fucks about Pro Dota. It was around TI5, I bought the compendium, and then I went on Dota 2 Lounge. I'm sure you guys are aware of that. It's just like CSGO Lounge, but it's for Dota 2. And I bet a lot of rares, okay? I bet my Arcana, right? And I got a lot of rares off that and shit. So I started winning a bunch of money, and I started getting like real invested into like studying and doing my homework and trying to like, oh man, like EG's definitely gonna win here, and you know, LGD's definitely gonna lose here and stuff like that. And CDEC, we talked about CDEC, right? They a wild card team, and they made it all the way to the finals, and they lost, unfortunately. And I say unfortunately there because I bet on them, and I won like $80 worth of rares off of like nothing but $10 rares that I threw on them at the start. And it was absurd. I was winning all this money and crap like that. And I'm not trying to sound like a fucking peddler or anything like that. Like, I wasn't making absurd amounts of money or anything. But like, the return on my investment was insane. And I was like, dude, holy crap. I started to get to know every single one of the members, like from a like research level. And like I said, I was caring a lot at that time about Pro Dota. And then I lost to EG. They won against EG. Then EG played against LGD. And then EG came back to play them again for the grand finals, and for whatever reason, CDEC couldn't just beat them again in a best of five. And I lost like $50, and it was crazy. And since then, I've given up on voting on Pro Dota. It is impossible for me to say for sure. It seems like what Asker was saying, it seems like EG's looking pretty strong. I don't know though, like their winning team from TI, they kicked off AUI, and then they brought RTZ back on, and then they went on to lose in the to OG, which is a pretty strong team from the little bit of research that I've done, but they dropped some games to them in the Frankfurt Major, and I don't know, overall from what I've seen in the Shanghai, like they perform pretty well, and nothing against them or anything like that, but like Secret, like we were talking about, everybody wants Secret to win. They were like voted most in the compendium for TI5 to win, and then they dropped games to I think it was eHome, right? Or was it eHug? I can't remember. They lost to them. Like everybody was sure the Secret was going to win it, or at least make it to the grand finals. And they lost to, like,
they got first. They got eliminated by Virtus Pro in like round of eight.
Was it?
Okay. Yeah, that was another Secret roster as well, though. Like only Poppy stayed on that team.
Yeah, it was Kuroki, yeah. S4, Sai, and Ortiz, right? Or what was it?
Yes.
Yeah. And I thought they were looking strong then. I don't know about the team synergy, but just if we're looking at individual players, like I think Ortiz is a very solid player. I think Kuroki's a very solid player. I think Puppy's, like, everybody agrees he's like the best captain. And I don't know if everybody agrees, maybe I'm wrong, but like everybody I've talked to thinks that Puppy, he's been around Dota for so long, he's like a really good captain, knows how to draft and stuff like that. Like I thought that was a pretty winning comp, and I put them up in my top three for the TI5 compendium, and they, I don't know, they lost pretty early on. So when it comes to me voting on Pro Dota, probably, you know, put my bets on EG. If I had to give two after that, I don't know. When I used to bet and when I used to take it very seriously, I always thought like Root was a really solid team, but I don't even think they got invited to the upcoming tournament. So obviously, it'd be impossible for me to vote for them. If you guys even know who Root is, they're kind of a smaller team.
Yeah. Monkeys Forever is one of my favorite players.
Is he? Yeah,
I don't think they exist anymore. No, I think they disbanded again.
Are you serious?
Oh, right. Well,
okay.
Monkeys playing Team Arkham with Fluff and stuff and those, and they were at the Major and came like last, I think. They made the Majors at least.
Yeah, that's a good point. I don't know. When they were on Root, I remember they were a pretty solid team, and I love watching their games. And like Power Rangers, I think they may have disbanded and reformed or some shit like that, but I love watching Cheshire Cat. Like all the teams that I would root for and say would be in my top three would never ever make it, because I always love rooting for the underdog, and I like to see players that like have a 10% chance to win on Dota 2 Lounge, you know, just upset the crap out of the crowd. Like those are the funnest games for me to watch. But yeah, if I could at least, I mean, if I could at most put one particular team in, I'd probably have to say EG, just because of their solid performance all throughout what I've seen in the past year of them playing Dota. Even with the roster switch from AUI to RTZ, which I still don't understand, by the way, but whatever.
Well, I can make like one fast comment about that. Like, if you see the curse of the other TI winners before, like Alliance or whatever, that kept on going with the same roster, they instantly lost. So I think that they did they had to make a choice. Like, we have to do changes instantly to not start losing like everyone else, because people will look at the TI winners and start to counter what they're doing and whatever. So if you add a new player, they cannot do that. Like, they cannot look at your replays or whatever. But yeah, let's move on to Mavo. Let's focus on him here a bit. You recently started to work, like not work, but started to going to start to work as an esport teacher as a whole, and whatever. Can you explain a bit more what that is and what it like, what you do and whatever? It's a pretty interesting thing.
It's a high school level in Sweden, and it's I think it's two schools that already started, and it's going to be a couple more to start up this fall. And I'm working with one of them as the program manager or the teacher. I'm responsible of the esport program at this high school, and I think it's for. It's like an extra program that you choose after you pick what direction you want to study. So you pick IT or and then you can pick esports on top of that. And it's not like many people think that it's going to be that you sit around and play games all day. It's the approach that we have taken to it is that we want to. We want to teach them things that, you know, we feel that esport players nowadays maybe lack a bit, but that they also can, if they decide not to be in do esports when they grow up, they can actually have some use for it in the rest of their lives. And it's a lot of like sports psychology and conflict management, and you know, they teach them how, if they eat right and sleep right and they also work out, they can do better when playing games and focusing, taking a lot of see a lot of how what's happening like in the chess scenes, where pretty much all the top players now is also very working a lot on stuff like that. But we will also teach them, like, you know, basic, you know, how to read a contract, or they're going to experience, you know, they're going to do a project where they do an event, esport event, or a tournament, so they can see that side of things. And we're just trying to give them a very broad, you just widen the pyramid. So if you get a wider base, you can reach higher up. And just, you know, prepare the next generation of esports pros, pretty much. And the approach that we had taken, that's pretty much, it's kind of different than all the other schools, because most schools just open up for all kind of games. So they have some Counter-Strike players, some Dota players, some League of Legends, some Hearthstone, some StarCraft. We decided the first year that we're only going to do MOBA games, because it's League of Legends and Dota, and because it's so much easier to get more specific education that works for those games that are pretty similar, though, and it's much more similar than Counter-Strike and Dota or Hearthstone and Dota. And then we're gonna see if we're gonna add more games later on. And it's gonna be, for my school, it's gonna be 15 students. That's for 3 years. They're gonna study esports together, and we're also looking to the possibility that we're going to create like 3 teams that's going to play together for 3 years. I think it's going to be, we haven't really decided yet. It's still very much trial and error phase right now. We're discussing different scenarios, and this whole week I've just been sitting reading sports psychology and look at different theories and see what we can bring in from that world. And just trying to be, you know, like super serious about it. But it's, I think it's a big step for esports that this is something that's, you know, that's happening now.
Yeah, and I would definitely agree. But let's say, you said you had 15 students, right? Or how many? Yeah. Let's say all these 15 students, like, if you wanted to do like that, three teams or whatever, what do you do, like, if you have too many, like, let's say support players or whatever, or will you guys force them into playing different roles or like stuff like that? I know that you said like they're not gonna be all about play.
Yeah, no, it's what when they get accepted to the program, what we do actually is first is all about the grades. You need to have the correct grades to get in. Then after that, we take in and see what level they're playing on right now, and then we do interviews with them. And that's both to find the right kind of personalities to do this, because we need youngsters that can... Because, you know, if you go to an esports school, you kind of get a permission to play as much computer games as you want to. We need people, kids that still will do their homework and still will do the school stuff and you know, got the working moral to be able to succeed in both fields, because that's very important. But in those meetings, we also get to see what kind of players they are, will there be a good captain? Are you a leader? Are you a follower? Or stuff like that. But you need to remember, it's very young kids. It's, you know, you're 15 years old, and if you come on, if you say like, yeah, but I'm a carry. Well, people change roles all the time in esports, and you need to be a good carry. You need to be able to play a good support, or you need to at least know the basics. So I don't really see that as a problem.
Yeah, okay. If you look back, like, Sweden is a pretty successful esport country, I would say. If we had this before, like, say, like in the 1.6 days or whatever, like, extremely, do you think like we would have become better? Do you think this in the future is gonna like skyrocket the Swedish scene or whatever, just because we're one of the first or whatever? I know that Korea has a lot of more of this stuff, but I think that we have a different approach to it. Do you think it will matter a lot?
Nah, I don't think that we maybe we'll get more pro players out of this. What I think might happen is, even though people need to understand that even though gaming is big in Sweden, and if you are born in the 80s or later, you have played a lot of video games, or you have friends that played a lot of video games, you have a relation to the gaming and probably pro gaming as well. People play Counter-Strike or whatever, but it's still how can I say this? It's still like an ugly culture thing here in Sweden. It's not like music or regular sports or so on. It's a bit ugly to with the gaming, and stuff like this is something that will change that, because, you know, most parents that come and ask, when we have had like possibilities for parents to come in and talk to the school, most parents that are, you know, they just wonder what are you doing this, and when we start to explain our what we're gonna do and why we're doing it, I still haven't had anyone that's been have a negative attitude towards it after we had a meeting with them. So it's because when they see that it's the serious approach, and it's you know, it's about respecting the interests of your of people or your child or whatever. So it's people. As I said, I think it's going to be a part of changing the attitude towards gaming and esports in Sweden to something better than it is right now.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's it's really interesting, and I wish you all the luck in that. But let's move on in the podcast.
Yeah.
The subject was titled "The Road to Competitive Dota." Mavav is basically going to talk a bit how it's to manage a team and stuff like that, and Oscar can share. He's playing in a team right now with some friends of mine. I gladly call them friends. And I don't really know Wire's like relation to competitive or whatever. But let's start with you, Wired. Actually, how's your relation to competitive Dota? Is that something that interests you, or?
I mean, at most, I'd probably say that I'd, you know, play with like three or four friends if they ever wanted to get on Skype together and dabble in the ranked party queues. That's like, I don't know, is that how, I wonder if that's how competitive teams even start. Do they just play ranked party and then just hit 6K and then say, hey, we're pretty good, we should like contact somebody about seeing if we can start a team or something? I know that Dota has its own built-in like team building feature, but like, you know, hitting 7K party MMR doesn't mean that you're gonna get like contacted by Gabe Newell or, you know, the International or whatever invited. So that, I don't know, when it comes, I mean, I'd consider myself a pretty good position 4 player, like probably enough to fill for some 6K team or whatever at most, right? Like, but that's not saying too much in terms of your actual ability to play the game if I can just kind of play one or two heroes and I can play them pretty well in one position. So I don't know. I'd have to, it'd be a lot of work if you're talking about me as a competitive player. But if you're talking about like my relationship with competitive Dota, like we kind of talked about that earlier.
I said it wrong. But you as a player, like, have you ever played in a tournament or whatever, or do you like look for a future in it? Or
We talked about StarCraft earlier. I used to play a lot of StarCraft 2, and I played in some StarCraft 2 tournaments, and that was pretty fun. And those were, I mean, those were a blast, honestly. Like, just spent a Saturday night playing for, gosh, I can't remember what they were called, but it was like just $20 on some website. They hosted it every I think it was every Saturday, and that was really fun. But when it comes to tournaments for like Dota or team games, I know that a lot of them, like, I don't have four other guys that are as dedicated to the game as me. I mean, like, I got a couple of people that I'm in contact with, but like, I don't have anything lined up yet. So I guess at most I'd say I'm searching, but at the least or middle of the ground, probably more rationally, I'm just kind of sticking to solo queue as of right now. I'd still need to develop myself as a player before I even thought about trying to join a team and make a team work, you know?
Yeah. I can see that. So let's move over to Oscar. What's your relation to competitive Dota and like your history in it and whatever?
I started following the competitive Dota scene like start of 2014, like watching tournaments. I hadn't watched prior to that, just pop spamming really, since like the early 2012 where this beta was somewhat established. And it wasn't before like mid of 2015. I just played a pub with some Danish dude, and he was looking like for a fifth, and then I played in that team for a bit. Wasn't very serious. Then I met our mutual friend Beryl, and when the Danish team disbanded, we stuck our heads together and formed a new team. We've just been playing together ever since. Yeah, that's pretty much it. I have no results at all in like competitive Dota, in terms of tournaments or whatnot. We just scrim, and sometimes we're lucky to beat like an established team, like something like Big Red Machine or Spin to Win, or what else could you meet? Maybe the Pro Dota team, the CIS team, from time to time, but nothing real fancy.
Okay, we have two players talked, but how is it to like manage a team, Mavo? Like, how is it to manage COOKISS? For example, what do you do? Do you like fix up the lobbies? Have you guys been to an event yet? Like, tell us a bit about that.
Yeah, I had so many questions about the manager role in esports, because it's so diffuse. It's really not comparable to anywhere else. In regular sports, not like your manager within the music industry. It's itself. It's a known thing. Most managers are pretty much just schedule monkeys. You try to keep contact with all tournaments or tournament admins, because it's pretty much the same admins that runs all major tournaments, and just keep track of all matches and all games, and make sure that the players just can show up and then go play. Also schedule scrims and stuff like that. But it can be so much more, and it all depends on the team, the size of the team. It can be a business manager role where you are trying to get sponsors, or you are or more like a personal manager role where you help the team with schedule stuff, and when you go away to events, you keep track of where everyone is and make sure that everybody shows up on time everywhere, and makes everybody's life much easier. So it's a bit weird. My role right now with COOKISS is we're a team that's still in the starting phase. It's much just trying to get everybody into the schedule monkey thing that I was talking about earlier. But it's there's also we had a couple of organizations that have been reaching out to us, and we're it's always interesting to see what everybody's offering. We haven't really been looking for anything, so like with my earlier teams, I've been in charge of negotiating, and when we have been traveling to events, I've been making sure everybody's tickets everything is working out, and just making sure that everything, you just want to put the players in a situation where they are kind of just focused 100% on doing what they're supposed to do.
So I know that your last team that you was manager for was Lemon Dogs, right? And that kind of went over to become like kind of COOKISS, like, you know, Steph Style and Eskil or whatever from Lemon Dogs went and made COOKISS. Do you have a personal, like, are you basically Eskil's manager or whatever, some relations to that, or do they ask you to keep managing, or how did that work?
It's in the end of COOKISS, it was pretty much the same lineup that we had already in 4FC, so they've been playing all together for a really long time, with small changes. And when you try, we're playing really hard. There's a lot of good working ethics in this team. We scrim a lot, we play a lot of matches, and when you get to a certain point and you feel that you never get to take that next step, you need to start looking outside the box. And at one point you get so far outside the box that the only next step is to try to shake it or destroy the box and just do something else. And that was happened with Lemon Dogs. And you always try to see what's happening next, and E-Skills and Steph Style and Pablo, we started talking what's the next step we're gonna be, and I started working with them. It's actually E-Skills left the team before Lemon Dogs, and we had five who joined us, so it's actually Steph Style, this the only player that was still in Lemon Dogs in the end. And he's if anyone, I want to be a Steph Styles manager, because that's the most easiest guy I ever had to do with. There's never any issues. He's just there playing and doing his best and doing a great job, and he's a great guy. So it's no personal problems with anyone, no fights, nothing. So it's I can be Steph Styles manager. That's that's nice.
So sounds like easy job. But let's change subject from esport as a whole, and let's go to some really nostalgic shit, like the origin, everyone's origin of Dota, like basically how you got introduced to the game, and like what made you stick to Dota of all the other great games out there. I have a really, really personal like relationship with the game. Because I still remember the first time I opened like a lobby, or when I started entered a match of Dota, and I immediately understood that there is so much to learn about this game that my brain cannot even comprehend it. Like right now, I was like 13 years old or whatever, and that really amazed me. And I still have that feeling today where there's something new to learn every day. Like I feel like I learn at least something from every pub game or whatever, and that's why me myself have sticking to it, because it's a game where it fits me as a person, and it always become I can learn something new in like all the time. Like if I play like an MMO, it like World of Warcraft for example, it will be kind of like a routine game where I do the same shit all over again. I never had that feeling about Dota or whatever. But so how did you guys get introduced to the game and whatever? Like, let's start with Wired. How do you got introduced to Dota? You can talk about Dota 1, of course, if that's where you got introduced.
Yeah, no, so I might get crucified for this, but I actually, not for this part, I played StarCraft 2 for a very long time. I played StarCraft Brood War for a very long time, and then I switched over to StarCraft 2 when it first got launched. Hated it, went back to StarCraft Brood War. Then eventually I made the transition back over to StarCraft 2 when it started to get a little bit more balanced for the race that I played, which was Zerg. And I started to kind of like it a lot, and I started to play it a lot. Then I started to play League of Legends, because I got a little bit over StarCraft 2. Which is where I thought I'd get crucified, but I don't know. I feel like everybody's dabbled with League a little, at least a little bit. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe you guys all secretly hate me right now, or not. I don't know.
And I just want to add in quick, like League of Legends and Dota 2 are completely two different games. It's like comparing the CS GO to Call of Duty. It's not the same mechanics at all. Like it's so much different in so many ways. I don't see like why people compare them. It's like comparing TV shows. Like you cannot do that in my opinion. Like there are different things. It's weird. They're the same. Like
I'll say that's stuff. I'd say that's definitely true nowadays. Back when I played League of Legends, it was like 2011, there were still heroes in the game that had like 50-second stealth, kind of like Ricky and or Bounty, I guess more specifically. There was heroes in the game that were like they had a lot of Dota-like mechanics. It was when League was still trying to be kind of like a Dota-like. It's when like they were still trying to attract Dota community players. And then it started to branch off as I started to leave the game. Because the first time I ever played Dota 2 was like when they were vastly changing League to remove stealth and remove these heroes that had been in Dota-likes for ages, you know. And really, really unfair. I remember my first game of Dota thinking like I hope that this is everybody's first experience. Like this is the way that I'd like to introduce a new player to Dota, is to just show them Faceless Void, Omni Knight, like a bunch of really annoying heroes to play against because they just seemingly are so overpowered and so way to any sort of new hero. Talking like Ricky, Bounty Hunter, like throw all the things at them that will make them say, wow, how is that balanced? Like there's a hero that can make your entire team immune to physical damage for 10 seconds. How is that balanced? There's a hero that can jump on you and within a quarter second CC your entire team so that he and his team can wail on you. How is that balanced? You know, when Pitlord gets added to the game, like how is it balanced that there's a hero in the game that can teleport his team anywhere on the map, you know, where there's creeps and stuff. Like that's like I fell in love with Broodmother the first time I played Dota 2 because I was just like, how is this balanced? There's a hero that can just permanently be invisible in a lane, summon spiders, stomp on her lane. This was back when she didn't have free pathing, but she cleared trees with her webs. So she was a different hero back then. But like just everything about Dota when I first started playing, it was just so absurdly insane. And like you start to put the puzzle pieces together as you play it, like, you know, this is balanced because he has a low stat growth, or he's a very slow movement speed hero, so the challenge is trying to leverage his low movement speed or his low ranges. Like Lion has low attack ranges or low spell ranges with his abilities, so before you get a blink dagger, positioning is key, and he's a very slow hero too, so getting into range to be able to cast your 2.75 second or 3 second stun that's in an AoE, and then also your like 4.5 second hex, like getting in range is the real problem with that hero. So you know, you start to learn these tricks of the trade, and you learn balance from a totally different perspective. And I guess to answer the question more black and white-ish, my origin with Dota was kind of my origin into like a totally new world of how games could be balanced, where everybody feels incredibly overpowered, and it's just like how you exploit your own hero's overpoweredness better than how your enemies can exploit their overpoweredness, so to speak.
That's basically how I say it also. Like I had a lot of questions about, like, Tinker was my hero. I was like, this guy refreshes all his items and abilities, like what the fuck, how is this a thing? But then I realized it can work. Like you can counter him and whatever, there's are heroes that works against him and so on. But Askar, how did you get interested in Dora, and like why do you still stick to this stupid game?
I just remember finding it in a random lobby back in Warcraft 3 when you were browsing for custom games. And why I stuck with it, I don't know. I think it's like the mystique and like the like being having all these heroes at your disposal and you can only play one at a time. And back then you couldn't like back then you wouldn't really read up on you couldn't like target your enemies and read their spells or your allies for that sake. So you had to play through every single hero to understand what they were sort of capable of. And I guess just going through them one at a time, every time you got wrecked by one of them, and then when you were through them the first time and you thought you understood it, then trying them the second time and perfecting the craft essentially. I don't know. I think it's like Dota's appeal is that the skill ceiling is just so high and the mechanics are so intricate and there are so many of them that interact very uniquely. To go back to an example of WoW for example, it's like the same few of the same mechanics applied constantly across like 8 classes. So yeah, I don't know. Started back in like maybe 2006 or 7, but yeah, and then switched to Dota 2 and like as I said earlier in the early beta, and started competitively in like mid 2015. Yeah, I don't know. I think it's a deep philosophical topic what the appeal behind the game is, but I think it's to a high degree that just the intricacy and the depth of the mechanics and how the game works overall, and you're sort of introduced to a new perspective on the game when you start watching commentaries and competitive play. Someone like Crit from OG at the summit talking about like things that the casters never talk about on the casting couch. Makes you realize it's quite the game.
Yes, it's really, really fucking deep, this game. So, Jonas, Mava, how did you get introduced the old man?
I remember playing one game of Dota 1. Only one game that I can remember. And I think it was... I'm not sure what hero it was. I was working this festival in Norway, and we were talking about gaming, and they were playing DayZ, I think I remember, and they wanted me to play with them when we were not working at the festival for the rest of the year, and I said sure. We played DayZ for like, it was like early alpha, and but then they started playing Dota instead, just jumping from game to game, and then they're like, yeah, play Dota with us, and I started playing Dota. That was just after the TI2, I think, and I just got hooked because it's very deep, and you know, I'm a very competitive person, and if you like to, you know, compete against people, then Dota is perfect. And it was like I took a step away from computer gaming and esports and everything for like, you know, 6, 7, 8 years while I did my last university and working and stuff like that. And I just had gotten back to computer games and bought myself a gaming computer and stuff like that. And then, you know, it was so much to learn in Dota, and so I found a hero that I wanted to be really, really good with, Jakiro, that wasn't played that much back then, and I played Jakiro a lot, and I was like, yeah, this is so much fun. And, you know, since I'm a competitive person, but I realized that I couldn't be playing competitive myself, I got pulled into the esports side of it through events, and you know, this side of esports. So that's by my foot. But you know, I watch a lot of Dota, but I don't have that much time to play Dota. So it's really frustrating when, you know, your fingers you can't do what your head wanted to do, because then, you know, I know like, you need to do this, you need to do this, and but I can't do it because I don't play enough, my mechanics is horrible, So it's
Yeah, it's it, like you don't even have to I don't feel like you have to play it to be invested in the game. Also, I think you're as invested as we are in the game by just watching it as much as you do, or whatever.
No, but it's like I have what I have. I have 14,000 hours in Dota, but I have played like 2,000 matches.
Yeah, that's a lot of AFKing or just watching, basically, or what?
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, that was basically like it was so much longer than I thought this was gonna be, but I guess we learn and whatever. But I just want to thank you all for joining this first horrible podcast I wanted to do, and I really appreciate it. Like, if you guys want to say anything or something like that before I end the video, it's now is the time, boys.
Had a great time. Learned a lot. I feel like a bigger person. Thanks, guys.
It was good. Yeah, I appreciate it a lot. Thanks for having me on. Hope we do this again sometime. If not, I understand. If you all hate me. No, I'm just kidding.
No, it's good. Shout out to everybody that needs a shout out.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Let's thank you that you have there. I hope you guys enjoy the podcast, and I will probably try and do it better for future. Leave comments or whatever what you want to improve or what I'm doing horrible. I guess see you in the next video. Bye.